So I was taking a look around Reddit earlier this week, as I tend to do, and there's a guy on the electronics subreddit showing off his first 4017, CD4017 circuit. And it was the standard classic 4017 and 555 timer 10 light chaser thing. This has been a classic circuit forever. It's something that you find in a lot of basic electronics books dating back to, well, when those two chips, the 555 and the 4017, were created. And I thought, hey, that's cool. I used to really like playing with that. I want to do that. And then I remembered I bought a couple of kits with exactly that circuit on it from eBay a way long time ago, and they're sitting here. There's one right now. I think I'm gonna build it. But rather than just stuffing the parts in the circuit board like it says in the instructions and soldering it, and if you follow the recipe, it's gonna work, I thought I would do it a little bit differently. And so, when I bought it, I actually bought two of them. I figured I'd put it together on a breadboard, first of all, so that I can play with it and experiment with it a little bit. So, let's do that. So the circuit's very basic. You've got basically two chips. There's the oscillator, which is what 555 is meant to do. That's its big thing. It's its claim to fame. And this is pretty much the most standard basic version of it you're gonna find. You've got a capacitor, and oh, this one's got three resistors, but these two are just in series. So basically, two resistors, R1, VR1 is part of R1 because they're in series, so you can adjust the speed. R2 and C2, the capacitor. And you do a little bit of math on those using this formula here. Constant 1.44 divided by R2, which is this guy up here, added to R1 squared, which is these guys here, but I've just written it out for this as R1 plus R1 plus VR1 plus VR1. So that's basically that whole lump of resistance squared, and then you multiply that whole thing by the capacitor. So resistance in ohms, capacitance in farads. So in this case, it'll be 2.2 or 2200 plus 47,000 plus 47,000 plus 50,000 plus 50,000 if it's maxed out or somewhere less, multiplied by capacitance, which is 0.00001 farads. 1.44 divided by that whole thing equals the frequency, which you can do the math if you want. R1 is either 47K at one end with this shorted completely right, turned right to nothing, or just shy of 100K. And that works out to between, what is it, 6 and 16 kilohertz or something, or 6 and 16 hertz. Which, when we get going here, we'll actually measure it and see if my math is right. And I'm fairly confident it is because I didn't actually do the math myself. I used some online calculators that I found. So, we'll do that in a second. So we got here, and I've done it up in two halves, just like it shows in the schematic. So I've got the oscillator there, the 555, variable resistor, the 1 microfarad capacitor, the 50K resistor, the 2.2K resistor. All right, and then there's one pin that is not connected to anything in this circuit, pin 5. Normally, the classic example circuits you see show a small capacitor on there, That is the control pin, which generally would be used to control the pulse width, the duty cycle. But in this case, we don't really care because we're just pulsing this guy. So the white wire there is coming off pin 3, which is the output. I've just got it linked over to the 4017. Now then, on the 4017 side, so its job, it just counts from 1 to 10 and goes back again. There's a couple of other things you can do with it, but that's just by modifying that count, but that's basically it. So it takes the frequency in. It's a couple of control lines here, and then there's the 10 outputs. As if we look back at here, they don't line up nice and neat like you would hope that they would. This is actually the order that it sequences in. The diodes are labeled in the sequence that it goes in. So pin 3, then pin 2, then pin 4, blah, all the way up to pin 11. So what we have over here, tied to ground, pin 8 is the actual ground pin. Pin 15 is, or 16 rather, is the power. 13 and 15 are two controls. One of them basically inhibits the oscillator input, which is on pin 14, and the other one is a reset pin. Now the reset pin is kind of cool because you don't have to count all the way to 10. If you only wanted to count to 3, you would connect the fourth one, in this case pin 7, to the reset pin, and it would just go 1, 2, 3, reset to 1, 2, 3, reset to 1, 2, 3. And that is used in an awful lot of chase lights that you see on marquees and whatnot, light shows, dance bar light shows and stuff. They don't, if you see there's a dozen lights, they don't control each one individually. They control them in groups of three. So you have 1 and 4 and 7 on, but only one control pin for that. And then that'll go off, and you'll have the next group of three, or the next group spread out by three, and then the next group spread out by three. So let's light this guy up here a little bit. And power on there. And on there. And let's just make it go. So there we are. That's as basic as it gets. For this kind of a circuit. There's these 10 guys. So I've got the variable resistor over here. And right now, I'll turn the resistance down to minimum, which changes that calculation so that there's only the 47K on that one resistor. So it reduces the amount of resistance in the circuit, which charges the capacitor faster and makes it go faster. Put the maximum amount of resistance in, that slows it down, increases the amount of resistance in the charging circuit of that capacitor. So things we could do to change the speed, obviously change the resistors, which we just did. We could also change the capacitor to a different size of capacitor. Larger capacitor is going to slow it down, smaller capacitor is going to speed it up. That's fairly straightforward. And actually, let's just pull in a couple of things. Let's pull in an extra LED here and plug him in there and plug in a resistor to him because you always want a resistor in series. And what have I done? If I put that in backwards, I have. There we go. So that's the oscillator blinking away there. Yeah, you can see that. So that's at the slowest with this combination of parts that came with the kit. Speed it up. Yeah, you can see it, not a flicker there. That might be actually a little bit hard for you to see with the camera, but I can see it naked eye here. Let's just, for fun, clamp onto that oscillator there and pick pick up some ground here. Turn this guy on. Should have had it powered on already. Menu, Hertz. 9.8. Just shy of 10 Hertz at its slowest. And we'll speed it up to the fastest. It's 19.7, pretty much 20 Hertz. And menu, where's duty cycle here? Percent, 50% duty cycle. So that's close to a square, in a perfect square we're going to get. And if I wanted to change that, which there's no reason in this application to do it, but if I wanted to, I would add a capacitor into pin 5 and throw its value into the calculations. If you were to go on Google, which everybody would do, that you wouldn't, these days you wouldn't go into a book and look this up, you would just Google it like I did earlier, and calculations for 555 A-stable multivibrator or A-stable mode, you'll find all kinds of tutorials that'll go through this in excruciating detail, and also some automatic tools that will give you the calculations. So that's that guy there. That's the oscillator side. Now then, the other half of it, the 4017. Okay, zoomed in on this guy a little bit. So here, these yellow guys are the two control wires. Pin 13 is the clock inhibit. Right now it's low, so the clock's not inhibited. If I do take it high, if I did that with a switch, it would be a lot more stable. The clock is now inhibited, and it's just stuck there. Clock is still clocking. It's ignoring it. It doesn't like being in a don't care state. And the other one, which is really useful, is pin 15, which is the reset pin. So as I was saying earlier, if I wanted it to only count to 3, I would put the reset pin on the fourth one, and as soon as that goes high, it resets the count back to 1. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, and you can do that on any of the pins. So if you have an application that only has to go to there, or wherever you want it to go, right? And that works with any. There, I've got it on the third one right now. It's just counting 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2. Which can be useful as well. So that's really the absolute basics of this guy. And put that back, put the reset pin back low, and it doesn't reset. If I put the reset pin high, it's just going to stay on 1 because it's, right? It's constantly resetting back to 1. So there it is. Now, hopefully we know a little bit more about it. And I'm going to get the building. Yeesh. That one got flattened. Shipping will have to fix him up. We have 555. We have a 4017. We have a variable resistor, a 1 microfarad capacitor, a couple header pins, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 red LEDs, and 2 other resistors. One should be a 2.2K, and one should be a 47K. I'll just double check that. See a yellow band on there, so that should be 47K. Yep. Which means that guy is the 2.2K. Let's just double check that these are actually the 1K resistors that they claim to be. And they are. Okay. So we got everything we're expecting. That's good. Next, I think I am going to just straighten this socket out. so that it will actually fit in the board. That side was easy. This side, that's not bad. A couple of these tweaks back there. Okay. So where does he go? 555 goes there. So the notch screen printed on the board, that means that that end, and specifically this pin here, is pin 1. The socket helpfully has the same notch on it. The reason it's a nice thing to use the sockets is so that you can, if you damage something, you can replace the part, obviously. But, oh, nice, satisfying, quick one that way. But also, when you're soldering, you don't accidentally overheat the chip and kill it. And then, kind of an odd design. I guess that's just to make the tracks easier, but on the 555, the pin 1 is that way. On the 4017, it's that way. Just make sure to get that socket correct. Pins are a little bit out of alignment, but I think we can work with it. Just slowly work them in. That other side's all in. Where's my little screwdriver here? Just to nudge these ones into place. What's going on here? That guy's splayed out a bit. Okay, I bent it. There you go. Those guys both sat in there. And when you're putting stuff onto a board, oops, sorry. You're putting stuff onto a board, you tend to want to do it, or at least I do, and this is kind of, again, old school, because that's just where I come from. You want to solder on the parts that are least likely to get damaged by heat first, and the ones that are most likely to get damaged last. If you can manage it, if it mechanically works out that way. Which in this case, it should do. So I'm just doing the corners first, just to get it physically held in place, and then fill in the middle. Always keep your tip clean. Doing three-dimensional things through a two-dimensional camera lens is kind of difficult. And I'll just repeat for this socket. Okay, there's the sockets in place. Matching the screen prints. So the next things that are, the next things on the durability scale are going to be the resistors and the ceramic capacitor. So again, I wanted R1 is the 47K, which is this one. I'm going to poke a few things in here. I and just give them a little spread on the back so they stay put. R2 is the 2.2K, which is that one as we measured earlier. You could bend these with pliers or tools, but these leads on these little guys are so soft and easy to bend, it really doesn't matter. I'll just solder those guys in. See, I'm using a couple of different tip cleaners. I'm using this sponge and I'm also using this little curly thing here. I know the sponge is what I've used since the beginning of time. And the curly thing I've just gotten in the last half year or something. I'm still not sure. Still not completely used to it. If there's a lot of crud and oxide on the tip, it sure does a quick job of it though. Okay, that's that. I'll get my brand new flush cutters that I opened up in the last mailbag. Snip those guys off. Ta-da, done. Get that one a little shorter. But it'll launch itself into my mustache. Okay. Next, I think I will do those 10 current limiting resistors, the 1K resistors. These guys here. They're the current limiting resistors for the LEDs, R3 to R12, and they're in fact 1K. If you can see that, cool. I'm just going to strip them all off their carrier here, plug them all in and solder them. You see me soldering resistors and plugging in resistors, so I don't think I will leave this at real time. I think I'll speed it up or even just... Alright. Take a look. See there? That's not too horrible. Okay. Oh, missed. Didn't bend that guy properly. Right then. This is funny. Could have left it like that. Electrically, it wouldn't matter. It would be ugly, but it wouldn't matter electrically. Again, this doing three-dimensional things through a two-dimensional camera lens is a real pain in the butt. Hey. Snip, snip. Okay. That's more bitter. Now then. What is next thing? I'll put the 50K potentiometer in its spot. Its legs are intentionally bent into little S curves here to provide a platform for it and to let it grip in there to make for easier soldering. Wasn't that thoughtful of those little guys in the factory? So you see two of the pads, the wiper in one end, are tied together there just like it is there. It's not strictly necessary to do that. You could have this end disconnected, but if the wiper loses contact or whatever, then that goes open circuit. So by having it like this, if the wiper loses contact, then it just goes to the 50K, the maximum. Something else that was discussed last week on the electronic subreddit, same place that inspired me to want to do this particular thing now. Okay, what else we got going on here? Let's drop in the capacitors. The electrolytic goes there. It's polarized. Plus goes to that side. However, on the capacitor itself, it only has a negative marking. So that obviously goes to the side that isn't positive. Shook like that. Shove him down. And give those a little bit of a tweak out so it doesn't pop up like that rogue resistor did. Okay, now then, the LEDs. Is that the LEDs and power pins? Get up here, you. The ceramic capacitor. Actually, let's put him on first. Ceramic capacitors are not polarized, so it won't care which direction I drop it in. Let's just put it that way, just because. Give the leads a little tweak to hold it in place. Yep. That capacitor is not part of the timing circuit. Yeah, clean my tip better here. This capacitor is just what you call a decoupling capacitor. It is straight across the power pins, which are right above it there. I'm just going to try and shove them in blind, which isn't going to work out for me here. So, okay. Those aren't going to hold in place for me politely while I solder them. Yeah, I've got the board tilted a little bit more vertically, but still, I'm going to put my finger back there and risk burning. Okay, that one is just tacked in. It's not a pretty join, but it'll do for now. And again, my tip was getting dirty there, so it didn't transfer the heat properly. There, the first one's done. The second one's done. Back to the first one, add a little bit more solder. Ta-da! It's happy. Now all that's left is the LEDs to solder in. The common side on the LEDs is the cathode side, which is going to the common or ground voltage. So that's that side, which is typically, see, there's a flat side on the diode. There's a little straight line there. But I'm just, so that should be the negative side. But I'm just going to, where'd you go here? I'm just going to double check on my LED tester. That is correct. See, there's a flat side on this side. It's also the short lead, which is the negative side. So those flat sides, short lead, negative side, all go in like that. You could put them right down to the board. There's a little wide spot there. I'm going to use that as my limit, and I'm just going to do this and repeat this 10 times. I'm going to use a trick that it's probably as old as the hills. You've likely seen Big Clive doing it because he does a ton of LED projects. I solder one lead, then bend them physically into a nice straight line, and then come back and solder the other lead. Okay, there's all the LEDs in place. They're a little bit wonky, but that's okay because I can straighten them up as I'm going here. Now then, I'm going to solder the common side first, just because they're easier to get to. They are, but I'm going to have to shift it in my vise a little bit so I don't melt the rubber. Okay. See how those look. Oh, not too concerned about elevation, really. I could be a little bit more careful, but what I'm more concerned about is that they're all in a nice straight line here. Those ones over there aren't, and they look kind of goofy. So I think that's pretty good. I'm going to flip this over, only because I'm right-handed. And get a good thing to clean on there. Okay. Just give those a quick trim. Okay. I'll prevent them from launching everywhere. It is moderately painful, you know, because they're still launching with some force. They're just launching into my finger. Alrighty. Now would be a good time to look for short circuits. Solder bridges, cold solder joints, weird blobby solder joints, forgotten solder joints, yeah, there's a lot of flux on there, which I can probably clean off later. I'm not that concerned about it right now. Let's plug components in. First of all, I'm going to straighten the leads out. All nicely in alignment and parallel. There are tools for doing this. If you're doing a lot of assembly, it's probably not a bad idea. I'm not all that concerned about it. So, notch that way, notch that way. Pin one bottom left corner in the way you're looking at it. So what I've done is I put the far row of pins in first on this side here, and then kind of wedged it in and shunk. They're all nice and flat down there. Check this guy out. There's a couple of pins curved in there. Match them up with everybody else. None of them are too wonky that direction. Okay. Notches up this one. Well, I'll do it this way. So, got that row in. And then I'll just lean this and push against all of them at once. Shunk end in. And just make sure that all the pins focus. Thank you. All the pins we need, none of them folded under. That should be it. Okay, I'm going to hook up power to this and we'll see what happens. All right, got a couple of DuPont jumpers here. Let's throw on there to 5 volts and woohoo! The monster lives. So let's Turn that all the way that way, it speeds up. Turn that all the way that way, it slows down. Push that into alignment so that it doesn't bother the two OCD people in the audience who haven't run screaming already. And there we are. So just like the one that I threw together on the breadboard, and pretty much exactly like every beginning electronics person for the last 40 years has thrown this circuit together when they're starting to play with digital electronics. Thanks for coming along on my little adventure here. That was a fun little nostalgia trip for me. Hope you enjoyed it. Maybe one or two of you learned something, or maybe you already knew this and you spotted something that I did wrong that you can tell me about down yonder in the comments. Thanks for watching. Talk to you later.